tell you what, it's pretty hard being a man these days. Let me tell you why.
This is rubbish.
Mom, I'm watching that. What I'm trying to say is if you're a young man right now, you're inheriting a much different world to your father's.
What'd I miss?
Shut up, Dad.
From the home to the workplace, our role is rapidly changing, and it probably should.
But the reality is, a lot of dudes are having trouble keeping up.
Whoa!
Are you right?
Yeah, fine.
Look, there's no doubt, men still get paid more, but we're becoming less educated, less skilled, and the jobs that we traditionally used to do are disappearing. Then there's the fact that we drink more, we drink and drive more, we smoke more, we do more drugs, we deal more drugs. So unsurprisingly, we die younger. Men get robbed more, bashed more, murdered more. By who? The vast majority of cases, by other men.
Despite all of that, we're a lot less likely to seek help for any of it, which might be why, on average, a man takes his own life every 4 hours in this country.
I'm not looking for sympathy. I'm wondering if this is something that we could change.
Thanks.
And guys, I know what you're gonna say. It's not me though, not all men. What if we instead said, yeah, we can do something about this. We can make it our responsibility. What if we said, yes, all men.
And where better to explore that idea than at a March for Men, where hundreds of people have turned out in support of men's issues.
You're recording something for your YouTube channel today?
Yep. Thank you very much. My YouTube channel is Johnny Moore, after myself. The main issues that are affecting men are just generalising all men as pigs, sexists and rapists. It's just man-hating and what they call mansplaining.
Actually, I don't think my idea is gonna fly here.
Yeah, we're all pigs, we're all violent, we're all this, we're all that. No, we're not all.
Little boys are told not to be boys. Little boys are told that it's not good. You've got to be less masculine. Masculinity is toxic, apparently.
No one wants to listen, man, right? That's the main thing we are coming here to support, man.
I've been affected by domestic violence. You know, domestic violence isn't just physical, it's emotional abuse as well. To try to find someone to turn to for support is very difficult. You know, no one kind of wanted to listen to what a man was going through.
Many of the men here say they feel unfairly targeted. But this march is divisive.
Mate, give me that! You are out.
It's attracted its own counter protest of people who believe these men have another agenda.
We can see your Nazi side. MRA, you can't hide. We can see your Nazi side.
Fuck Antifa!
Fuck you, Antifa! They're just ordinary people, mate, that are just men that are probably a little bit tired of the rubbish that's been put on.
See any reasons why people would come to that conclusion about men?
Well, it's just the stereotyping of what happens, you know. There's violent men in the world, there's violent women in the world.
The other thing I can't help but notice is how many women are here.
As a woman, why did you come down here?
To support my brother, my father, my partner, you name it. Like, all good. There's a lot of good men out there, but yet men are getting a bad name. Majority of them are men. Why the fuck aren't they on this side, fighting for men's rights?
In fact, this whole rally was organised by a woman. This woman.
I am a woman standing here today telling you that women have the same rights as men. It is ridiculous to suggest that we don't.
Conservative commentator Sydney Watson says the March for Men grew from the commentary surrounding the rape and murder of aspiring Melbourne comedian Eurydice Dixon in June this year.
It's a response to the media coverage and the headlines and these talking heads that represent our boys, our young boys, as would-be killers or would-be rapists, and it's just absurd.
You're fed up.
I'm fed up. I think people here are fed up. No one's getting out in the street getting upset about the fact that men are murdered considerably more than women, and men are victims.
The hands of men.
Sure, but there's also a portion. See, this is again. I don't look at it based on who perpetrated. I look at it based on we shouldn't have crime in this country. We shouldn't have people being hurt in this country. Who perpetrates it doesn't matter.
It seems like people here are doing all they can to protect masculinity, to say it's not men's fault. But that doesn't get us anywhere. And that last argument, it's bullshit. Why would we ignore the obvious fact that the vast majority of violence is carried out by men? And unless we own that, nothing is going to change.
Well, I thought I was different to everyone when I first got there. I'm nothing like these people. I'm different. I haven't done anything really bad.
This is Steve. He recently completed an 18-week rehabilitation program for men who've been abusive towards their partners.
I thought DV was for people that were violent, which is one thing that me personally, I'm definitely not. The last thing you'd ever think you've done or would be doing was hurting your family. There was a lot of anger, there was a lot of blame. You know, you get the shits, you kick something or you throw something the other end of the room. You know, the behaviour that's supposed to be okay because everyone's done it forever. It's about the way it's taken and the impact it has on the other people around you. If I've got a child standing there watching that, being scared, not feeling safe in their own home, it's not on.
When we initially have an interview with the men, we will go through what's called a behaviours checklist. It has over 50 different behaviours. It's really not about whether they're physically violent, whether they're emotionally, financially, sexually. It's not about the actual behaviour. It's about the motive. And the motive behind the behaviour is control.
Relationships Australia's Michael Riley and Susan Alvery have been running these men's behavioural change programs for nearly a decade. Michael is an expert in family violence, in more ways than one.
Must be tough hearing some of those things from men. How do you deal with that?
I was always a little concerned of, because I've grown up in a family with domestic violence, and we didn't see a change. It existed for all of my childhood upbringing. The beatings, seen a whole range of abuse that had occurred, but people wouldn't believe us.
Do you think that your dad would have benefited from a program like this?
Absolutely. Although I still hold a great level of disdain towards a lot of the things that he has done, seeing the level of change that men make, gain not just the skills and the strategies, but more it's that personal awareness. I want to be a better man for myself, and then as a consequence for my family.
I remember her saying to me, I can't do this. I'm like, what are you talking about? She says, either you got to go to where I am. And the fact she did that, and I think it's the best thing she's ever done.
Must have taken a lot of reflection to get to that point.
I did not see that in the beginning, no. It wasn't something I would have come to on my own. I don't think, we'd never argue, because we wouldn't argue, because I'd shut it down. I didn't want feelings anyway. Because that's the only thing that can hurt you. And that's what I think I've guarded myself from my whole life.
You think there's something that all men can learn about the way that they treat others, their partners?
No doubt. The first people I told my kids, I've done things, I've said things, I've acted out in a way that's made you scared, frightened, anxious. I'm working on never being that person ever again. And that's my goal, and that's what I'm gonna do. If this hadn't happened to me, what happened, I'd still be doing the same thing.
The vast majority of men, they don't wake up in the morning thinking, oh, I'm gonna wake up and go and hurt my wife this morning, or I'm gonna be abusive. It's often through their childhood experiences how they've picked up some of those attitudes and mindsets. It is a predominantly male, and it is a predominantly gendered issue that we need to address. It's a man's issue.
My name's Marty Smiley.
Cut, come into this frame.
And I'm on a mission to reframe what it is to be a young man in Australia.
Oh yeah, I'm one of them.
What does it take to be a real man?
Muscular, testosterone.
Big, strong, tanned ones.
That power and recognition.
Stoic machismo.
The one that holds us together.
Doesn't have emotions, doesn't have feelings, but just shrugs everything off.
Men are afraid to cry, men are afraid to show emotion. They don't know how to talk about it. It's just something that's just laughed off, I've noticed.
My stepbrother committed suicide 3 years ago, so it's something that's hit fairly close to home. He was one of those silent sufferers. He was someone that didn't reach out. And I don't know how much of that is because we haven't created the opportunity or space.
I went to a all-boys high school. That kind of toxic masculinity did come through.
It's definitely a thing, even though it's a buzzword.
A lot of the time I think it would be comments, especially about women. It's manly to have, yeah, sort of a negative view of women.
Sort of like predatory behaviour.
I don't really approach, but it's just like iron off girls. People get catcalled.
Men grow up thinking that they're not supposed to talk about their emotions because it makes them less masculine.
What do you look for in a man?
Honestly speaking, like a good beard would be nice. Take note, boys, I'm available. Anyone? What's so funny, Marty? Am I telling a joke here, Marty?
Yeah, that's funny.
I should take over this now. Thank you.
So, if we're going to tackle the issues that affect men in this country, we probably need to start thinking about what it means to be a man. I'm on my way to meet someone who had to find that out the hard way. And in case you can't tell, this place is hardcore. Kobe.
Hey, it's doing, bros.
So this is the place where you work out?
Yeah, it's where the magic happens.
At nearly 21, Kobe Duncan has already faced more challenges than most of us experience in a lifetime. Amongst many things, he's a champion boxer, a sport he claimed saved his life.
Boxing, for a long time, my life was... It meant everything. In the ring, when I'm fighting, there's no other feeling like it. It's therapy every time I come in here. Punching these bags is therapy for me. Sparring is therapy for me.
Tell us about the place you grew up in.
I grew up in Maruba, South Maruba. We call it Lexo. You wouldn't go through Lexo by yourself. It was just a place full of drugs, alcohol, violence. It wasn't a good place when I was younger. Well, my dad was around until I was probably 4 or 5 years old, and then just one day it was just, that was it. Like, I just didn't see him again for another 10 years. When I'd be at school and watching documentaries or we'd go on field trips and I'd be like, oh, that's my dad. Just cause all my friends had dads at home.
What kind of man did you aspire to be when you were growing up?
I wanted to be seen as a thug. I was trying to be like the baddest person I could. Like, I didn't want to be seen as a kind person or, cause that was just weakness. We got caught for like breaking in the cars. I got locked up. I got taken to the station. Like, I got arrested. I went from a very depressive state and I just used drugs just to feel that, just that hole in my chest that I just felt every day.
Was there a turning point for you?
I ended up in hospital. Took like 3 pills at once. And then sort of before they really kicked in, I took another 3. Bad decision. I was like, I gotta go home. And I went home and it didn't stop. I thought that I was gonna go crazy. I thought I was gonna be like that forever. Just the look on my mum's face, like, I just realized how much it hurt her. Boxing was, it was my way out of it all. I got in contact with Brad Hardman, my trainer.
Doubled up. I can remember the phone call got off his mother and said, you know, he's done something wrong here. See, I've been around boxing all my life. You know, the old saying is, hard work beats talent. He had all the talent in the world, just has to put the hard work in.
I won the New South Wales Featherweight Championship. And then the next year, I moved up in weight to lightweight. And I won the championship for lightweight championship. It made me take action in my own life. It made me take control of my own life.
Was boxing always your dream?
Nah. I started making music when I was 8 or 9, is when I wrote my first rap. It's a Southeast team, now fucking that's me. Young boy coming from the SYD. Never gave a fuck what they thought about me. Something that was just my way of expressing myself. It's like, it's motivating and it's inspiring for me. And especially music for me is a way for me to get my message out. I'ma say what I want, do what I do. Fuck fitting in, I ain't trying to be you. Tell them right now.
Right now. Thank you. Alright, let me introduce you to Marty. Marty, this is part of the family.
Kobe was effectively raised by you and your sisters, so by women. How did that change how he was brought up?
Like, Kobe's very kind and giving, and not saying that you can't be like that if you're not raised by a man.
Yeah.
But I think it, played a big role in the person that he is today.
How did you get him through some of the tougher moments in your life?
We had a big roller coaster ride of him just always showing him that no matter what, I'm always here for him. I always just showed him love no matter what.
We were both young mums. She was 16 when she first had Kobe, and she definitely has became a stronger woman from being a single... Oh, I don't want to cry, from being a single mum. And I told her the other day that she inspires me. I'm proud of her. Because of her, he gets to write his raps. If it wasn't her journey as well as his, he would have nothing to say.
I've always said to people, the sun shines out of like my son. I've always like, yeah, he was starting to prove me wrong. I just wanted him to see in himself that he could do better. And thank God he did.
Yeah, I say that quite properly, Mum. How does the quote actually go? Sunshine.
Sunshine out of...
my son's ass.
Yeah.
The other night at the gig, you sort of let something slip. What was that?
I'm going to be a dad, so make some noise for me. First time.
I'm expecting a child, and me and my girlfriend. There's nothing more in this world that I want to be than a dad. Like, not having my dad there, it just makes me know that I'm going to give my kid everything. I just can't wait to be there for my child the way that my father wasn't, and just show that child like the love that my mum showed me, or the love that I got from my family. At a point where I'm not afraid to be who I really am, and you can hear it in my music. I'm not afraid to show people that I want to be out in my community helping as many people as I can. I want to show young men that it's not unmanly to love, it's not unmanly to show emotions, it's not unmanly to cry. It's like, I want to be that person that kids look up to for the right reasons, and not for the reasons that I was looking up to the wrong people in my life.
I'm Marty Smiley.
Awesome, cheers bro.
And I'm trying to reframe what it is to be a young man in 2018.
Thanks brother.
Until now, I've kind of avoided a big issue, and I can't any longer because right now, it's the worst it's been in a decade. It kills more young people than car accidents or any form of cancer, and at least 75% of them are men.
Oi.
Hey.
Hi, brother.
Good man, good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Good to see
you. Bought me a beer.
Yeah, you wouldn't buy them. Cheers.
Cheers, mate.
This is my mate Chris. He's smart and funny. But every day he pays
not
dearly for a decision
morning.
He made a decade ago.
We're meant to talk about something today that a lot of people have trouble talking about. I'm having trouble just bringing it up right now.
Suicide. It's not something that we do as men or society very well. We don't talk about feelings. Just gone 10 years since my suicide attempt. Yeah, I feel like my life before then is irrelevant and started 10 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that how you think about it?
Yeah. That person died and now I was born.
Can you tell us about that life beforehand? What that was like?
I thought I was like any other sort of guy going through life, and I had a car, I had good friends, it was all about footy, boys, sex, money, power, all that sort of stuff. Yeah, had the good-looking girlfriend, had a job. Everything from our side was pretty awesome. But I was kind of living a life that I didn't really like. It wasn't really for me.
Why was that?
I couldn't let people know how I was actually feeling or what was going on inside me. My mum and dad broke up when I was young, and like, because I told myself I'm never going to be like that, I'm never going to leave my family. And when my relationship broke up, I felt like I'd fucked up my life because I had this opportunity to be happy. And I thought I'd just pissed it away. I didn't want to die, but the voice saying just fucking give up was that much louder than the one saying push through. And I attempted to hang myself. And while I was in the process of hanging by my neck, I realized, shit, nah, I can turn this around, don't want this. Tried to get out of it. The chair that I used to...
You were standing on a chair?
Yeah, I was on an office chair with wheels. It was like, you know, about an inch or 2 inches away from my reach of my foot. And I had to hang there and think, shit, what have I done?
Fuck.
Like, I find it hard to describe the terror that brought, terrifying. Like, I haven't felt fear or anything as strong. My dad's partner found me. I was getting worked on in the backyard for 45 minutes before I started being alive again.
I've never heard of anyone not being here for that amount of time, 45 minutes, in limbo.
There was a period of time where people wouldn't talk about what happened, they wouldn't talk about the event, and that really drove me nuts. Like, it's just like, well, can't pretend it didn't happen because I'm living through this shit every day. And for me, it's so real. My brain was starved of oxygen. It's mainly physical disability that I have. Simple things, walking down the street, catching a train to work. Like, there was a time where I was just like, fuck, now this is life for me.
How did you come back from that?
A lot of rehab and a lot of counselling. I had friends come around. I had my psychologist, psychiatrist, and those professionals helping me out. It took a while to like see the value of that, hey, I've got another chance. Just when people know who are in that deep dark pit, that like there's other ways out. I've been in worse situations, I've felt worse, but now like I've got a toolkit. I'm at uni, I'm studying HR business degree, and my life's completely different, complete 180 to what it was.
What kind of man do you now aspire to be?
Just someone who can show their emotion, show their vulnerability, say when they're sad. Men struggling in silence, trying to be stoic. It doesn't help us, doesn't help men's families, doesn't help kids. It doesn't help. If we continue to do the same thing, nothing will change. Men will continue to die. It doesn't have to be like that.
Thank you as a friend and, yeah, for doing this and for telling your story.
Thanks, man. Cheers.
Cheers. I'll get the next one.
Yeah. Well, shit, you will.
Chris's story is confronting, but I also think it's inspiring. If after all he's been through, he's found the capacity to change, then maybe there's space for me too. I'm going back to see Michael Riley. I want to go through that checklist of abusive behaviours to see what I can learn.
What I'd invite you to do is just to go through, you can just scan through those behaviours.
I'll go down the list, things that you could have done to your partner or an abusive relationship. Slap, grab, punch, push, bite, burn, pull hair, poke, claw, scratch, tack with a knife, smashing things, throwing things, trying to make her feel guilty about not having sex. Having sex while she's asleep, oh my God. Criticizing her clothes, criticizing her body shape, making her think she's crazy, putting her down. I mean, yeah, that's something that I've definitely done in relationships in past. Yelling and screaming, making her feel guilty, definitely. Having unreasonable expectations, definitely. Using jealousy to justify your actions.
And that's maybe a subtle one?
Yeah.
I'm only worried because I care for you so much.
What does it say about me that I can see and identify three or four things on this list that I have done or been responsible for?
Well, firstly, it identifies that you're honest. But what it says about you as a person, there are some areas that you would benefit from changing. It's not to say that you're a bad man. Good men will do bad things. What are we doing about those things that they have done? And so it's the same with yourself.
Thank you so much, Michael. And that's it, right? Even if we don't think we're one of those men, are we willing to take a look at ourselves and challenge our behaviour? The men I've met have. They're proof that if we can't open up to change, we're destined to keep hurting ourselves and the ones we love. If we get stuck saying, it's not me, then we can expect more of the same. If we truly want to break the cycle, it's going to take all men.